This space probe is the greatest achievement made in the history of mankind. Voyager 1 is a space probe made by NASA, which was launched on September 5, 1977 to study space outside the solar system. As of 2012, Voyager 1 became the first spacecraft to travel beyond the limits of interstellar space and cross to the heliopause, and it travels at a little more than 38,000 miles per hour. But it has been transmitting some very strange signals as of late. What could be the reason for this anomaly? Could it be that it has been intercepted by alien lifeforms? Let's take a closer look to see what's going on. The problem is that it's sending telemetry data back, which indicates that it can't send telemetry data. The Attitude and Articulation Control System, or AACS, is responsible for pointing the antenna to Earth and to determine the orientation of the spacecraft. But since it clearly is sending telemetry, this means that the data is faulty. Specifically, it's sending data which states that the antenna is not pointing at Earth, but if that were so, then the data would not be received. Since it has been in space for over 40 years now in a harsh radiation environment, this suggests that radiation damage has built up to a point where ability to report the spacecraft's orientation no longer matches its actual orientation. The telemetry is not weird, so to speak. It's a computer running in an unknown radiation environment several billion miles away. What is happening is the telemetry is reporting the spacecraft is in orientations, past and present, that do not match what the spacecraft is actually doing, including orientations impossible for the spacecraft to get into, given current system's configuration. They know it is wrong because if the telemetry was correct, the high-gain antenna would not be pointed at Earth to receive this data. The fact they are talking to the spacecraft, when the spacecraft thinks the antenna is pointed away from the blue planet, tells NASA the issue is with the data stream. Odds are good that Voyager 1 is in a high-flux portion of the bow shock just outside the heliopause, and that radiation is corrupting the storage for the telemetry data. Most people are surprised the two spacecrafts have gone this long without issues like this. The problem could clear up, it could remain, and they would work around it, or it could be the first signs of immediate system failure. The computer systems on the spacecraft are radiation hardened, not radiation immune, and a lot of their storage is on a magnetic media, and they are in a highly charged particle environment. For all we know, it could be a radiation flux environment that is responsible for these perplexing transmissions. The exact cause hasn't been diagnosed by NASA teams either. As they said, until the nature of the issue is better understood, the team cannot anticipate whether this might affect how long the spacecraft can collect and transmit science data. And then there is an issue with the information relay. It takes 20 hours and 33 minutes to get to Voyager's current interstellar location. So a round-trip message between the space agency and Voyager takes roughly 2 days. Also, the Voyagers are designed to enter safe mode if something goes seriously wrong, but it hasn't. It's not only the Voyager 1 that's been acting weird lately. Its twin sister, the Voyager 2, has also been showing some of the same problems, most probably because it's running out of power. It's been in flight for more than 42 years since its launch in 1977. It's traveled around 11.5 billion miles in that time. For scale, it takes light and radio signals 17 hours to reach it from here. That's about 2.5 times as far from the Sun as the ex-planet Pluto ever gets. From its vantage point, the Sun is a medium bright star, not the blinding source of light and heat we take for granted. To run its instruments and the radios it uses to send its readings back to us, it was equipped with 3 independent radiothermal isotope generators, or RTGs, that together could produce 470 watts when launched. Without those, it would just be so much precisely machined junk at a few degrees above 0 Kelvin. That capacity drops by half every 87.7 years. Sounds like it's been good for centuries, huh? Not so. Remember, it's still traveling away from us, and the farther it gets, the worse reception of its signal it gets for us. It has a 12-foot diameter dish antenna, but still, it has had to cut its data transmission rate from the maximum of 115.2 kilobits per second it could manage when it was near Jupiter, which is a mere 500 million miles away. Now that it's more than 20 times as far due to the adverse square law, it would have to invest 400 times as much power to its transmissions for us to get reception equal to what we could hear from it then. It can't afford that. Best it can do is keep decreasing its data transmission rate and only transmit when it's not doing anything else that requires power. Recently, it was supposed to use a remaining bit of its altitude control propellant to rotate one complete turn, so it could recalibrate a magnetometer. Apparently, it failed to do so, and two of its instruments were drawing power longer than it should have, so automatic cutouts tripped and it shut off its remaining few operating science instruments. Most have been permanently shut down to conserve power, but some can still run on the waste heat of other systems, so their dedicated heaters have been turned off. Why did it fail to make the scheduled rotation? That's what NASA engineers are hoping to learn, but they have to wait 17 hours for each command to get to the spacecraft, and 17 more for it to respond. It might take several such cycles for them to be able to troubleshoot a machine they will never be able to see again, much less touch. Scientists are just amazed that the old probe still works, 42 years after the planned mission ended. Everything after the Saturn flyby is just a bonus. And the engineers at JPL are not that worried either. As mentioned before, the planned mission ended 42 years ago, and everything after that was a bonus. Its cameras were shut down 32 years ago, but some instruments have been operating anyway, despite having shut down the heaters to preserve energy. But in a few years, there will not be enough power from the radioisotope thermoelectric generators to drive the radio, so it won't be possible to listen to it anymore. So this strange anomaly means that Voyager 1 may end operations a few years earlier than previously thought. It's not strange considering that it is currently outside our solar system at a distance of more than 20 billion kilometers. As of 2020, both crafts have been running on fumes after most of the plutonium-238 powering their radioisotope thermoelectric generators have decayed. NASA engineers will shut down most power operations to utilize the remaining power to transmit spectroscopes, magnetic, and plasma data, about the same power used to run a small LED wristwatch. After 2025, both Voyagers, having depleted their nuclear batteries, which are both about the same age, will drift in interstellar space, steered mainly by gravity. Both Voyagers are headed to star systems. Voyager 1 will be within 1.6 light years of Gliese 445 in about 40,000 years. Voyager 2 is heading to the star Ceres in a little under 300,000 years and will be within 4.3 light years. Both spacecrafts are traveling at more than 35,000 miles per hour. If the spacecrafts were to be suddenly stopped by anything, that would mean the end of their space odyssey. About their eventual fate, will they be intercepted by intelligent life forms? We honestly don't know. What we know is that both crafts will be confined to the Milky Way galaxy. Our solar system is traveling around the galaxy at about 514,000 miles per hour, 15 times as fast as the Voyager's current speeds. This means that in a few hundred million years, our paths will again cross, or certainly get close. Earth might already be vacant of humans in that time, but not necessarily in space. Humanity might be scattered all over the galaxy, and maybe, in a strange twist of fate, the golden records, humanity's message in a bottle to other intelligent life forms out there, were actually meant for our own descendants. So there you are, guys. I hope this video offers some good insight. If you enjoyed it, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe for more content like this. And as always, thanks for watching.